so much for coming out here on St. Patrick's Day. I can't say that any music is particularly Irish in any fashion. My shirt, my new shirt, has this wild green stripe, and that's the closest I can come to an over-the-top St. Patrick's Day celebration. By history and tradition, of course, three of the four composers on the program are of the same denomination associated with St. Patrick. In this country, you know, I don't think of getting wicked plastered in Boston or dyeing the Chicago River green as particularly spiritual. But anyway, more interestingly, of the four composers, three of them are in some manner, three different ones, are in some manner connected with church music. Both Vivaldi and Tartini, in different ways, were, well, Tartini was directly employed by the Catholic Church at the Basilica San Antonio in Padova, where he was the honored solo violinist, and I'll talk more about his concerti when we get there. But you know, he played a concerto many Sundays, most Sundays. It would seem that as time went along, he was able to have big leaves of absences if he wanted to travel and so on. That seemed easier to do back then somehow. Vivaldi was apparently a pretty lackadaisical one, but was ordained as a priest. Clearly was interested in music and didn't write all that much sacred music. And Bach, I think, wrote a sacred piece now and again. I know Bach's obviously the greatest church musician in history. So that leaves Leclair that we're going to open with, and that's of the four composers, as best I know, Leclair didn't write anything specifically for the church. He did a great service. First of all, an extremely accomplished violinist and composer, in the best sense, doing both, and he did a great service for performers in centuries to come by very carefully publishing all of his music. If after his Opus 1, his first wife died, and his second wife was a music engraver. And these are beautiful editions. So a modern edition like we're playing from, they all credit to them for doing so, but they really had very little work to do. One could play from these first editions. I've said before, you know, Leclair, much later, sadly, was murdered, and it was unsolved, and a 20th century musicologist, raconteur with time on his hands, came up with the theory that his estranged wife had stabbed him with her engraving tool. But anyway, that's unproven. So this sonata we're going to open with from his Opus 5, there are four books, Opus 1 of violin sonatas, plus one Opus Posthumus that his wife published after he died. So 49 total, four books of 12 plus the one. Opus 1 from 1722, Opus 2 from 1728, Opus 5 that we're about to play, an example of, from 1734. And so this is when Leclair is really pretty well known. And he's performing a lot in Paris. The Opus 5 is probably his best-selling opus. I think his very best works are his Opus 9, which are really magnificent. But by the time they were published in 1743, the musical taste was already shifting towards something a little bit more simple. And so they probably didn't sell as well. But anyhow, this particular one, four movements. Let me see. I have a couple of pithy notes here. Yeah, the second movement is essentially an Allemande, meaning a German dance, but just like Bach never really sounds French, Leclair certainly never sounds German. But it's kind of that slow four that we would associate with an Allemande, Sarabanda, a slow three, and then the special movement is the last one, the Ciaccona, which is a set of ongoing variations over a repeating bass pattern. And my very favorite Leclair sonata of all is one of the Opus 9 that I'm going to play again soon that ends with a magnificent Ciaccone. But this is a very beautiful one. He structures it in ABA form, minor key, middle section, and then we return to the major. So, you know, wonderful, wonderful work here. This is for violin and continuo, meaning what Leclair wrote was simply a bass line. And I wasn't thinking about this when I picked this. In the Ciaccone, there's a section, some of the variations are written for the cello. In other words, the full violin and basso continuo, if nobody's sick and everybody's there, it would be violin, a keyboard instrument, and a cello. You can, as we're doing, it works great with just the keyboard instrument. However, there, as I say, there's a separate cello line, so I gave Jim some extra work to do. He's figured out a way, I think he's using all the pedals, and it sounds wonderful. And I think all this music sounds terrific with organ, especially with a fine musician like Jim. So, anyway, Leclair, Opus 5, number 4, in D flat major from 1734.
sonatas, the Bach is closer to the old so-called church sonata, the sonata da chiesa. It originally started out in the late 1600s, the idea that, well, a church sonata would have a fugal second movement, it would not have dance movements. Well, that's very hard to enforce, so to speak, because so many pieces from the 18th century have dance movements. So this is by no means a sacred work, but it's in the traditional four-movement form. The second movement is the most complicated, the most imitative between the two parts. Probably the most, a couple of interesting points about these works, the Gamba sonatas, and I have to tell you, maybe I knew this way back, but it was, I remember sort of rediscovering, not last week, but maybe 8 or 10 years ago, I remember rediscovering what the word gamba means, and it sounds nice, but it simply means leg, right? It's just an Italian word for leg. So it means the gamba family, more or less like the cello, and it wasn't totally standardized. In other words, I think some gambas maybe were played up here, but most were played held with the legs, like a cello, and differentiating it from the viola d'amore, you know, which is an ancestor of the modern viola. Anyway, so Bach wrote three gamba sonatas, and it's interesting because his son C.P.E. Bach did the same thing. He also wrote three, and in the case, and in neither case is it a set. You know, Bach loved to write sets all over the place. The well-tempered clavier twice, the solo, the unaccompanied violin works, the unaccompanied cello works, etc. But these three are very different, and so he was not thinking of these as three works together. It used to be that Bach's instrumental music was sort of indiscriminately thrown in, like 1717 to 1723, when he was working for the court and the prince at Curtin, who loved instrumental music. I think recent scholarship has shown that this is maybe a somewhat later work. And the other interesting thing about it is that it's written completely as a trio sonata, meaning that there's a second melodic line in the keyboard. So it's not string instrument plus continuo, string instrument plus, well, the way I wrote it, I just said gamba sonata, but you could say sonata for viola da gamba and cembalo, which is different than saying for continuo, right, even though they were both most often played on the harpsichord. So it's a wonderful work, very, very appealing, and let's see if there was anything else that has to be said about this. Yeah, I tend to this edition, this is a pretty good reconstruction from the, or transcription from the gamba, and it tends to leave the part for the viola in the lower octave whenever possible. And you are hearing and will hear so much high violin writing that I chose to leave the part low. And I think, again, the way Jim is voicing the organ so beautifully, I think you'll be able to hear me. And there's nothing sillier than a viola piece that doesn't touch the C string, the low string, right? So what's the point of that? So I've purposely decided to play the lower octave whenever possible. All right, I hope you enjoy this Bach gamba sonata.
Thank you.
the Italians, I always like a little Pellegrino to give me just a little kick. Vivaldi and Tartini are both from the northeastern Italy, Venice. Vivaldi's Venice on the Adriatic. Tartini's Padova is only about, I don't know, maybe 25 miles or so. Pellegrino's from the other end. But these two great composers. Now we switch to concerti written for solo violin with string accompaniment. And again, I think the organ works beautifully here. And certainly I was talking about Tartini playing many weeks, most weeks probably, at least when he was younger, a concerto at St. Anthony's Basilica. Again, I'm sure there were many times he was accompanied by organ. As he got older, he apparently didn't much like the sound of the harpsichord. And some of his sonatas later, he really preferred just to have a cello accompanying, right? Part of that combination I was talking about, the continuo with the cello playing the bass line. But anyway, a concerto of the mid-18th century, solo instrument, string orchestra, harpsichord continuo as written, and again reduced here for keyboard. So this, some of you are, I don't know if anybody here has heard, in the last few programs I've given, I've played a Tartini concerto in every one, so maybe there's somebody here who's heard all three. You few, you happy few, etc. It's very difficult. Tartini, I think he enjoyed his music, and he was a well-known teacher. Unlike Leclair, he was pretty careless with his scores, and that's too bad, because it makes it much harder. I've sort of made a project to get as many Tartini works, particularly concerti, which I tend to think are his most expressive. You know what his most famous piece is, right? It's the Devil's Trill Sonata, which was the first work of Tartini that I played a long time ago. And I asked Jim, as a obviously a wonderful musician, but I asked him as a church musician how he thought, since a number of the programs we give are in churches, how would it go over if I played the Devil's Trill Sonata? And he said, well, it depended on the church. So, or he said, or you could play it and not tell the story, which is kind of defeating, right? Like talking about Beethoven's Eroica Symphony, but not talking about Napoleon, the man of destiny, and all that. So anyway, but Tartini's concerti are really expressive. The D number is a Greek musicologist, Minos Dounias, who made a project out of simply classifying them, and he didn't try, just like Bach's BWV catalog, done after the composer's life, or the Vivaldi Riom catalog. None of those, there's so much music, so much of it was not published. None of those catalogs try to put it in chronological order. So in the case of Tartini's concerti, it's simply identifying them and by key. So well, this is Dounias 51. So we're going up. This is in E major. In other words, Dounias number one is in C major, and we keep going, and Dounias 125 is in B minor. So we go through all the keys. And this one, Tartini liked to often put some kind of little motto with his concerti. It was typically something secular, so he made up a code so that the basilica wouldn't get offended. But in this case, it's Tortorella Bacci. And I have to admit, I didn't learn the concerto for this program, but I have to admit I learned what that meant from, if you get satellite radio, there's the Saturday morning Baroque show with the guy who really likes Baroque music and, talks about the craziness of multiple opus ones of Tartini. And it was from this guy that I got this motto for this concerto. Tortorella Bacci means turtle dove kisses, and it applies to the second movement, which is very lyrical, and it's not, I wouldn't say it's directly imitative of a dove, like say Vivaldi in Summer. He uses the same, he doesn't use the kiss part, but he uses the Tortorella in Summer, And I remember one of my college studios, somebody was working on that. And I said, well, you know, it's kind of like the mourning dove. Well, what's that? And so I did a mourning dove call, and that went around the studio and caused great entertainment. And then the hilarity became general because there was a young woman from Cyprus, and she thought it meant morning doves versus afternoon doves. And she thought it was funny, too. So anyway, but the 18th century composers like to imitate bird calls. In this case, this very sort of tender lyrical second movement. And this piece, talking about additions, I literally went over this piece bar by bar. I sort of gave up with the available addition, the second movement. I just wrote it all out, and which is an enjoyable and worthwhile project. But I always start out thinking, well, maybe this addition's pretty good. And then I find it leaves much to be desired when I get into a big project. Final thing, the Tartini sets up in the two outer movements, he sets up what he called capricci, what we would tend to call cadenzas, but he doesn't provide them. So I've written capricci at the ends of the two outer movements. And I've tried not to throw in everything but the kitchen sink. I mean, they're hard enough. But I think the nature of this piece is very lyrical. There's dramatic stuff, but it's not like the Tartini concerto that I played a couple of years ago, which is super dramatic. I think this is more emphasizing the lyrical side, and the capricci I wrote, I dare say could almost go, say, with a Mozart or a Haydn concerto. So, Tartini, it's a mistake to think all these composers are stuck in the Baroque, because Tartini was looking forward, and then above all, he has very lyrical, almost romantic sort of nature in much of his writing. So, this E major concerto, Dunias 51, Portarello Bocci from Tartini. Thank you. concertos on commission, and it kind of reminds me of Paganini just under 100 years later, who was charged with being avaricious, but I think he was probably just more a careful business person and was leery about putting stuff in print for fear rivals would lift it. And I think it strikes me there is an element of that with Vivaldi, because his published concerti, my favorite opus by far is the Opus 8, which includes the Four Seasons, but eight other wonderful varied works. But after that, his published concerti tend to get a little bit easier rather than more difficult. And he saved some of his most difficult writing for these concerti that are purchased by individuals or written. There's a woman violinist simply went by Anna Maria. A lot of his concerti for Signora Anna Maria are very virtuosic. This woman, Signora Chiara, I don't know anything about her. I looked very briefly and couldn't find anything. So if she was a performer and played this, she must have been pretty skilled, because I think you'll agree this is it's one of the more brilliant Vivaldi concerti that I know. Or maybe she, is an amateur, just wanted to acquire a timeless work of art at a reasonable price, which reminds me, ask me about an exhibit of my photography that's going to be at the San Martin de Porres Center for April and May by Ohio Dominican. Very beautiful venue. Anyway, this concerto, I think the outer movements are very brilliant, and then the middle movement is really pretty. And it, as I write, it's the same principle we heard in the Leclair Ciaccona. In this case, it's like a Sarabanda with variations. So a recurring bass line. Not nearly as long as Leclair Ciaccona, but it's very pretty. So I hope you enjoy this.
Thank you. one short slow movement in my notes there. I say that there's one other Vivaldi concerto that I know of. That's not to say there couldn't be another, but probably 150 or so that I'm familiar with. There's only two slow movements that have this varied set of variations. The other one is Opus 4, number 12, and we thought we'd conclude with that. The Opus 4 published about 1716, and it was in the one of the works of music that was in the library of Mr. Jefferson, you know, 60 or 70 years later. He carefully wrote down all the money he spent on violin strings and music and so on, even though he couldn't ultimately balance his own budget. But so it's interesting to think of Vivaldi in music form making its way to North America, you know, by the latter 1700s. So thanks for coming, and it certainly was a real pleasure to work on this music with Jim, and very nice to present it to you, and we'll look forward to more programs. Thanks.
see you tomorrow then.